so we're going to get started. So thanks everybody for coming to this tutorial. The other one looks pretty interesting. I kind of wish I was at the other one also. But hopefully we'll have some fun with this one. So I've been giving this tutorial for a fairly long time now. The first time I gave this was at ETIER in 2013, which was in Copenhagen. I was actually at Copenhagen 2 weeks ago for Rexis. So I work for a recommendations company now. And so I've been updating the material a little bit to be a little more general, to get away from just information retrieval systems and also talk a little bit about recommender systems and information access in general. So the title of the tutorial is called Statistical Significance Testing in Theory and in Practice. I'm not really talking that much about theory of statistical testing. If you start getting into the theory of significance testing, you start getting into concepts like sufficient statistics, efficient statistics, uniformly most powerful tests, asymptotic guarantees, and these are actually things that aren't that interesting to me. They're not that relevant to the kind of work that we do as scientists and engineers in computer science. What I'm really more interested in is talking about how the practice of these tests, the way we actually use these tests in practice in our day-to-day work, is pretty shallow. And if we had a little more understanding of not really the theory, but kind of the ideas behind these tests, we could get a lot more out of the tests and the way that we apply them in our day-to-day work. And when I say shallow, what I mean is that we don't actually learn very much about how these tests work. We might learn a recipe. We learn like a quick equation we can do. We look, you know, we can look something up in a table. More likely, we just learn a function in R or Python, and we get a p-value, and that's it. And there's a lot going on underneath the surface there that if you don't understand, then that p-value doesn't actually mean very much to you. So what I really want to do is tell you more about those underlying decisions or underlying things in those significance tests, how they affect our understanding of the tests, and then how we can take advantage of those better understanding to use the tests in a more productive way. So just to get started here, I want to talk a little bit about hypotheses and experiments. So when we talk about significance testing, we're talking, you know, really we're talking about experimentation. We're talking about experimental design. Typically, in search and recommender systems and machine learning in lots of fields in computer science, lots of AI fields, we'll have hypotheses that look like this. Something like using an SVM for classification will give better accuracy than using many things. That's a hypothesis. It's something we can test with an experiment, and then we can draw some conclusion about that hypothesis. And neural recommendation models are not providing much improvement over simpler approaches, is another hypothesis. In implementing systems, we can test that and come to a conclusion about it. Or another deep learning one, using deep learning to rewrite search results will improve mean average position in relative Turing independence. And to experiment with hypotheses like this, typically we'll build a baseline system, which should be a relatively strong baseline. We will either modify it based on the hypothesis, or we'll build an entirely new system that we can compare to that baseline system. And then we'll test both systems online and offline, compare the metrics, and see which one. It's very easy to find examples of papers that do this kind of thing. This is an example from a paper that appeared at Rexis 2019, so this is a paper that appeared at the conference 2 weeks ago. This was actually the best paper at the conference, this one best paper award. And it's called, Are We Really Making Much Progress? A Worrying Analysis of Recent Neural Recommendation Approaches. So they were actually doing the second analysis. And what I want to point out about this table is that there's a lot of numbers in it. They're comparing a bunch of different methods. They're comparing six different methods. And they report precision at 10, recall at 10, and DCG at 10. They don't actually report statistical significance between any of these pairs. So, I don't know. They have this 0.3327 precision at 10 value bolded. Is that statistically significantly better than the user KNN method, which is at 0.2913? No, they didn't say. So, from this, I'm not entirely sure what I should take away from that. In fact, this paper has six tables like this, or not, sorry, nine tables. So it has quite a few of these kinds of numbers, but no statistical significance. And you can see that some of these numbers do get pretty close to each other, which should make you wonder, are these results due to randomness, or is there something meaningful? So their conclusion in this paper is that neural methods can be outperformed by simpler approaches. Now, perhaps it's the case that over these 9 tables, you can take away, you can pretty firmly believe in that conclusion, but it would probably be more well-supported if they didn't have some statistical results reported. And that's why we care, right? We look at these tables of numbers and we say, do these results support the hypothesis? And when we see numbers like 0.56 compared to 0.55, it's hard to say without looking at something. Are these results meaningful? Is it possible that the differences are just due to some kind of randomness, something that we don't understand? And that's why we want to do statistical significance testing. So before I jump into some more technical stuff, I wanted to show this plot from a paper that I published a couple years ago. What I did is I downloaded a bunch of papers that have been published at the CIGAR conference over 20 years. The ECIR conference over 20 years and the CIKM conference over 20 years. And 10 years for the latter two. And I looked at how frequently these papers were doing statistical significance tests. And what I found is that from 1995 up to 2015, it went up from less than 20% of papers doing significance tests to just over 60% of papers doing significance tests. So there's a big change between 95 and 2015, where a lot more people started doing these tests. And the community realized the value of them. And it's becoming increasingly hard to actually publish papers without doing these tests. You kind of need to show significance, at least in information retrieval, maybe not in Nexus. But you kind of need to show significance in order to get your And in industry, you need to have statistically significant results to get systems deployed into production for large users. So it's an important thing, and the community is recognizing its importance. But again, there's issues that we need to discuss. It's not always clear cut how you should use it, how you should interpret it. Okay, so I have this tutorial split into 5 parts. The first part is just going to be an overview of some of the most common significance tests that we use in information retrieval. And so that should be probably reviewed for many of you, but hopefully there'll be some new stuff in there. Part 2, I'm going to start looking at some of the fundamentals of significance testing. And then part 3, I'll talk about some of the myths and misconceptions around significance testing. Part 4, we'll look at some of the applications, or why should we bother to learn about some of these things. I'll show you why in part 4. And then part 5, we'll kind of take a step back, take a higher level view, and think about what does it mean? What does significance testing mean in research? What does it mean in development information access systems? A little more philosophical discussion. Before I get to part 1, I want to just briefly talk about some background in experimentation in search and recommender systems. So there's typically kind of 3 ways that people look at evaluation. There's offline evaluation, online evaluation, and then there's user studies in the lab. When you do offline evaluation, you typically use some kind of test collection. You can think like a Trek collection, think like a movie lens collection for recommender systems. Or you have some kind of log that you've collected online, but then you're using for offline testing. With online testing, typically it's A/B tests. And then you have your user studies, which I'm actually not going to talk about very much in this presentation. I'm mainly focused on kind of offline evaluations and online evaluations at scale. There's a whole other set of issues around user studies and significance testing with user studies. So So for experimentation in search, the offline experimental setting that's been used for many years, probably 50 years or more, is called the Cranfield paradigm. And the Cranfield paradigm consists of a test collection and effectiveness measures. And the test collection consists of a corpus of documents that you want to index in search, a set of information needs that are supposed to look like ones that real users would have with that test collection, and then relevance judgments that tell you which documents are relevant to which of those information needs. If those are all packaged up, you can send them out to other people, everybody can use them, compare results on those. So it's a really nice thing to have. And then you have your effectiveness measures, such as precision at 10, average precision, and VCT. And then the way an experiment works with the Cranfield paradigm is you build a bunch of systems, search systems, and we have four systems. You take those canned information needs, the ones that are included in the test collection, and you just submit them to each one of those systems. The systems produce a ranked list of results, and then you take those relevance judgments that are included in that collection, and based on those relevance judgments, you calculate whatever the evaluation measure you're interested in. So for example, we might look at precision at 10, for these ranked results, and with five queries, you get five sets of ranked results and five precision at 10 values. Then we do the same thing for a system B, with the exact same queries, and we get five precision at 10 values, and then we do the same thing with two. And what that gives us is a matrix of precision at 10 values, where we have one value for every system query pair. And then we can compute the averages of those. And we can also compute averages over the topics. So it's really important that there's some variation in topics. You need to have variation in topics for it to make any sense to do a significance test. The kind of question you might want to ask here is, if you see this difference of 0.32 versus 0.28, does that mean that system A really is better than system C? Or is there something about the five queries we picked that maybe they're easier for system A for some reason, or maybe they're harder for system C for some reason? You could look at system C and system D and say that they have the exact same precision at 10. Again, is that because the systems are the same? Are they actually giving the same sort of value to the user? Or is it because of these queries? Is it that the queries just happen to be a little bit, some of them happen to be a little bit harder for system C and some happen to be a little bit easier for system D? And the difference just kind of averages out. The other approach to offline evaluation is using log data. So actually I have the exact same picture here as the evaluation. And really the only difference here is that when you're using log data, instead of looking at relevance judgments that have been collected, you would look at the user actions in the log. So you would say that system A retrieved a document at rank 1 for query 1, and then you look at your log and you say, did users click on that document and use that as some implicit relevance judgment to calculate some measure or some metric about clicks or click-through rates. Now, there's some issues with that. So if we're using log data that was collected online from some production system, then we're only going to get feedback on the things that production system has been showing to users. So if system A is retrieving documents or items that have never been seen in production before, we'll have no data on those, we'll have no implicit feedback on those items, and we won't be able to calculate these measures. We also have the issue of presentation bias. So maybe we do actually have implicit data on all these things that are ranked by system A, but maybe they were ranked in a different order in production. Maybe the thing that's ranked at position 1 for query 1 was actually ranked in production at rank 4 or rank 5 or something like that. And just because of that lower ranking, it got less interaction from users. So using log data is not necessarily the best solution, because you do have these kind of biases that come in from the production system. It's from what the production system is showing to users, how the production system is presenting that information to users. And there's various techniques for dealing with those biases, which are becoming really popular lately. One of the most popular ones is the IPS scoring. want to mention this because, again, statistical significance and experimental design are really closely tied together. And using log data with IPS weighting is an issue of experimental design. And it comes in how you interpret or how you decide to use significance tests. Then the other major approach to experimentation is online testing using A/B tests or A/B/M tests. And it's a very simple approach. You have two treatments you want to compare, or you have N treatments you want to compare, N systems. And you just you randomly assign users to the first system, second system, third system, fourth system, and so on. So in this image, we have our user happy face. The Z is an assignment variable or assignment procedure that randomly assigns that user to one of those systems. And then the user goes into that system, interacts with it, and we record metrics on that interaction. And then we can compare the systems by comparing those metrics. So one thing I want to point out about this approach is that here, when a user submits a query, they can only submit that query to one of these two systems. So they'll either submit that query to system A, or they'll submit that query to system B, but they won't be able to submit it to both because they'll only appear in one of those buckets. In the other two approaches I showed, the offline testing approaches I showed, you can get information from all the systems for one query. So you can submit the same query to all five different systems and see exactly how it would perform on the same query. And that's going to be something to talk about when we talk about SQL. So I'm going to start with a quick review of some of the commonly used tests. And while I'm going through this tutorial, I also have this Jupyter notebook where I'm going to kind of do some demos and stuff like that. Feel free to jump in, by the way, if you have any questions or comments, or if you want to test anything in the demo setup. The first thing I'm going to do here is load some Trek data. So Trek, for those of you who don't know, is an evaluation campaign conference. Trek runs a number of different tracks each year. Different participating sites participate in those tracks. They submit retrieval results, so they get a test collection from Trek. They run their retrieval system on that test collection. They submit the results to Trek. Trek collects relevance judgments from those results and then puts them all together in a large test collection for public release. And Trek has been doing this for over 25 years now. So this Trek 7 data consists of evaluation data from the 7th Trek conference, which was in 1998, I believe. And this evaluation data just consists of a bunch of different matrices. Each one of these columns is a system that was submitted to Trek 7, which is submitted to Trek that year. There are 50 rows because there were 50 topics in the test collection. And each value in this matrix is the value of the evaluation metric for that query for that system. So, MAP is mean average precision, or average precision, so 0.4663 is the average precision for query 1 for the system called ACSYS7AL. So I'm going to use this data for some of the demos we do. And then I'm just going to pick these three systems to look at. These are three systems that were submitted by UMass Amherst for Trek 7. UMass Amherst is where I got my PhD, so I'm just picking up the UMass of it. And for these three systems, we have I'm just showing here the average precision values for all 50 topics for those three systems. So I'll come back to this in a second. So I want to start with just listing some of the commonly used tests. So I have this categorization, non-parametric, parametric distribution free test. It's actually not that important, don't worry about it. What I want to talk about is these six tests that I have listed here in a little more detail. And I want to start with the sign test, which is generally considered to be the simplest test that we use. So let's say we have two systems. So let's say we have two systems, A and B, and we have 10 queries. And we run each of those queries on those two systems, and we record some metric on the results. The way we would set up a sign test is we would look at the difference between the two metric values on that query. So in this case, we have 0.35, 0.25. We get the difference of 0.1. And then we convert that to the sign of that difference. So we convert that to just a plus 1. And for our second query, we have plus 1. For our third query, we have minus 1. The fourth query, the two systems were tied. So we have 0. The sign, there's no sign on that, so we just assign it with 0. And then we go so down the topics. And the sign test is based on counting what they call successes, or you could think of it as flipping a coin and the coin coming up heads or tails. But basically, it's counting the number of positive results in the test. So we have 9 complete trials. We throw out the one that was tied, and of the 7 that are, or of the 9 that are remaining, we have 7 positives and 1 negative. And then we ask the question: what if we were just flipping a fair coin? What if we just flipped a fair coin 9 times? What is the chance that we would get 7 successes if we did that? Or what's the chance that we would get 7 or more successes if we flipped that coin, fair coin 9 times? Right? So you can flip your coin, you can do it 9 times. And then what's the probability that you would see 7 or more heads if that coin is fair? So going back to my using my cursor, so I'm okay. So I have that data, and then so when I run the binomial test in R, there's this function called binomTest. I say how many successes I have, so I counted 7 successes in that table. I say how many trials I had, and note that I'm counting 9 trials because I left one out. And then I say that I want to test whether system B is better than system A, or whether there's more successes from system B beating system A than vice versa. And when I run that, I get a p-value of 0.09. Okay, so what does that mean? So when you flip 9 coins, you flip 9 fair coins, sometimes you're going to get 4 heads, sometimes you're going to get 5 heads, sometimes you're going to get 6 heads, sometimes 7 heads. You can do it again and again and again, and you'll get a different number of heads each time. You can count up that number of heads and then plot them in a histogram, and that histogram should look something like this if that's a fair coin. So it should be that you see mainly, you should see mostly 5 heads, some 4s, some 6s. Some three, less 3s, less 7s, and so on. And then you can say, what is the probability that we would see 7 or more heads if that coin is fair? So you say, what's the probability of 7 heads given 9 trials and a fair coin? F, 50% chance of coming up heads. What's the and that's that blue bar there. What's the probability of 8 heads given 9 trials and half probability? And that's that blue bar there. And what's the probability of 9 heads given 9 trials and a half probability? And that's the last blue bar. And when you sum those up, you get a 0.09 value. And so that's where that p-value is coming from on the dimmer. So what does that mean? So typically we say if the p-value is 0.05 or less, we reject the null hypothesis. In this case, the p-value is greater than 0.05, so we probably would not want to reject the null hypothesis. Now I have not actually specified what the null hypothesis is, so let me specify that. The null hypothesis is basically saying that if the probability of the coin coming up heads is even, if it's a fair chance, Oh, sorry, that is the null hypothesis. So the null hypothesis is that Bitcoin is fair, or that it's always going to have an equal chance of having a positive or negative when we look at the results to it. So if we cannot reject the null hypothesis, then we cannot conclude that that coin is not fair. So what we're saying here is, if the coin is fair, then we can, what we're saying is, I lost my train of thought a little bit. I've been up since 2:30 this morning to catch another plane here. So this is kind of like the contrapositive in logic. So we're saying if X, then Y. And in this case, if the signs of the differences were generated by flipping a fair coin, then then the total number of positive signs should be roughly around n over 2, so 10 over 2 in this case. And that's what this distribution shows. And you know, in logic, then if you have if x then y, then you can also say if not y, then not x. And that's essentially what we're trying to say here. If the total number of positive signs is not around n over 2, then we would conclude that the signs at the end differences were not generated by flipping a fair coin. So we're making a very specific statement about how these things were generated. And in this case, we don't have the values of, or we don't have enough positive results to say it's around n over 2, and therefore we don't have enough to say that they were not generated by flipping a fair. Now there's a lot to kind of process here. So first of all, I want to point out that this model of flipping a coin to get a plus or minus one is not really what's going on here. These two systems, A and B, are likely completely deterministic systems. They were built by engineers. They take the query, they take the corpus, they do very specific deterministic things to produce results, and then those results are measured in a specific way to produce these metric values. There is no randomness in that process, essentially. You could say there might be some randomness in how the relevance is assessed in the documents, but even there's going to be some specific procedures that are used that try to minimize the relevance. So what does it even mean to say that the signs are generated by flipping a fair coin? I think it's kind of a strange way to set up the problem, and I think it's something that we should think about when we're doing this. I'm going to talk more about this in a little bit. Okay. So next I'm going to go on to the second test, which is the Wilcoxon sign rate test. So again, we have the same data here, and we do the same process of subtracting B and A to get a difference in the metric. And then this time, instead of converting them to sign values, we rank them. So we rank the differences from lowest to highest. And then we assign the absolute value of that difference, the rank value that it appears at. So the smallest difference is at rank 1, the second smallest rank 2, up to the biggest non-zero difference at rank 9. Again, we're throwing out the tie value. This time we can have ties in the ranks, so we do have two differences that are the same, and therefore they're assigned the mean of the two ranks they would appear at, the rank 5 and 6. They're both assigned 5.5. And then we sum up those rank values, and that gives us the test statistic of 40. So what does 40 mean? So what you can do with this test is you can compute an exact distribution of what that test statistic would look like if the null hypothesis is true. So again, we're saying if there's no difference between these two systems, like with the sign test, we said if we could flip a coin, then everything would come out plus or minus one, completely at random. In this case, we're saying if there's no difference between these two signs, then any difference could have any rank value. And so you could look at every possible ranking of values, sum up the ranks, and you get a distribution that looks like this. And then how do you compute, or how do you determine the p-value? In this case, you look for that test statistic value you just computed in that distribution. You compute the area under that distribution for that value and higher, and that is your p-value. And the nice thing about this test is that even though you could compute the exact distribution if you wanted to, you can also fit a normal curve to that distribution if it's very nicely, so you can approximate it with a normal distribution. And you only need about 25 samples to be able to do that accurately. So in this case, with the exact same data we had before, we get a p-value of 0.02, which in this case we would consider to be significant, so you reject the hypothesis that the two systems are equivalent. Now again, it's worth considering what we're really rejecting here, or what we're really saying. What we've said is that if we take this data that we obtained from these two systems, and if we transform it into these rank values the way we did, and then if we compare that to the all possible rank values that we could have gotten, then we would conclude that those two systems are not equal to each other. There's actually a lot of intermediate steps in there in between actually measuring those values and saying that the two systems are not equal to each other. And again, we should think about what it means to be performing all those intermediate steps before we take that p-value. Conclusive of anything. So back in my demo window, it's very easy to do a Wilcoxon test in R. You just say, I have my two vectors of evaluation values. I have this Wilcox.test function. I say paired equals true because I was able to run every query on both of the two systems. That means I have matched pairs for each value. And that gives me more power in my result. So then when I run this, I get this warning message that says I cannot compute the exact p-value with zeros. It cannot handle that zero value, so it throws it out. It computes a p-value without that zero, and then the p-value is 0.02, as I showed you. So you know, this is another thing we should think about, is if we have to throw out data to make the test work, is the test the right test for that? Does it make sense to use that test if it cannot accommodate all the data we have? Another thing I want to point out about this test is that now it's in the sense of the information we're retaining or information we're losing, we're retaining more information than we used for the sign test because we're taking into account the magnitude of the differences. But what we're losing is the magnitude of the differences between queries. So for example, there's a very small difference between the difference in performance in query 2 and query 3. The ones that rank 2 and rank 3, those are queries 9 and query 1. So system B, in terms of the absolute difference, system B is almost as good over system A for query 9 as it is for query 1. Whereas there's a much bigger difference between the one in rank 3 and the one in rank 4, which are query 1 and query 3. And we completely lose that distinction in this test. So then the next test I want to cover, probably the most important test in all statistics, but definitely the one that's been used the most well-known, the one that appears in the most different scientific fields, is Student's t-test. And Student's t-test does not perform any transformation on the data like the previous two did. It just takes that data. It does take the differences. So when we're using a one-sample test or a match pairs test, it'll take the differences between the results on each query. We'll compute a mean over all those differences. We'll compute a standard deviation over all those differences. And we'll use those two values as well as the sample size to get a test statistic. So that's the mean over the standard deviation times the square root of n. And then just like we did with the Wilcoxon test, we look up that test statistic in a distribution. This is called a t-distribution. And that will give us a p-value. In this case, again, of 0.02. And again, the t-distribution can be approximated with a normal distribution if you have enough samples. And it does not take very many samples for that without approximation at all. So again, in my demo window, I have a t-test. It's exactly the same setup as the Wilcoxon test. I run that, and I get my result with the p-value of 0.02. And you can see if you look out to more than just two decimal places, there's some difference in the p-values between the two. And we're going to look at what that looks like at a larger scale. I also want to talk about the two-sample t-test. So when you're doing an online test, you're sending users to one of two different systems. You're not going to be able to get every query run on both of your systems like you do in this example. What you're going to get is, for query one, you might have the result of query one or a metric value of query one for system A. For query two, you might have that for system A. For query three, maybe for system B. But you never have it for both of them at the same time. You don't have the same user query metric value for both systems. So in that case, you can't use the previous test. You have to use the two-sample test. And the two-sample test involves computing two means. It involves computing a different standard deviation called the pooled standard deviation. And then computing another test statistic, which in this case is a value of 1.6 as compared to the 2.3 from the previous example. So when we're not able to use matched pairs, we get a lower value of the test statistic. Lower value for test statistic means it's further along, it's closer to zero on the x-axis, and that means there's more area under the curve of the distribution, and more area under the curve means the p-value is higher, and in this case it's high enough that we typically not reject with a 0.05 rejection threshold. Then in the demo window, that looks like this. So what I did is I created this Z vector which says which treatment each one of the queries was assigned to, and then I run the t-test. I run the t-test on those two subsets. So the set of things that B was assigned to, the set of things that A was assigned to, I give a p-value of 0.07. So those are kind of those are three of the most common tests that have appeared in the search literature in the past. And again, the t-test is one of the most common tests used in statistics. A little bit of history about the t-test. It's over 100 years old. It was created by William Gossett. That's this guy here. He worked at Guinness at the time, the Guinness Brewery, and he was comparing different brewing formulas, and he needed some kind of test basically to compare measurements on those brewing formulas. And he came up with a t-test. He came up with this test to do that. And at his job at Guinness, he was not supposed to be publishing papers. So he published it under a pseudonym. He published it under the pseudonym Student, and that's how he got the name Student's t-test. Okay, so now I want to talk about some what's called distribution-free tests. So these are tests, as opposed to the previous three, they do not have kind of natural distributions associated with them. With the sign test, we had the binomial distribution. With Wilcoxon's test, we had a Wilcoxon distribution, which we could get a normal distribution to. With the t-test, we have the t-distribution. With these tests, there is no distribution, or we don't assume any distribution a priori. We basically come up with a distribution from data. So these are also called empirical distribution tests because they're based on formulating a distribution from the data we actually have. So for the randomization test, so the first test is called the randomization test, and this was created by Momo Fisher, who is a very famous biometric statistician, who created a lot of the statistical concepts that we use today. Fisher had data that looked very much like this, two treatments, measurements on each of those two treatments, differences between those measurements. And he could compute a mean on those differences, and that mean in this case is 0.214. And his insight was to say, what if the measurement was not actually associated with the treatment at all? What if, for my first instance, I could have gotten a 0.35 from treatment A? instead of a 0.25 from AAA. So he said, instead of taking the values I have, I'm just going to randomly swap some of them. So if you look at the table here, from here, so query one here has the values 0.25, 0.35, and a difference of 0.1. You could just randomly swap that and get 0.35 and 0.25 with a difference of negative 0.1 instead. And if that happens, that means the treatment has no effect on the measurement. So basically what Fisher did is he would go down each one of these instances, flip a coin. If the coin comes up heads, he would just change the sign value on that difference. And if not, he would not change the sign value. And then after doing that for all 10 instances, he would compute the mean of the differences again. So the original mean we computed on the original data was 0.204. After one pass through of randomly changing the sign of differences, we have a mean of negative 0.008. We could do that again, the exact same procedure. We get a mean of negative 0.093. And you could do it again and again and again and keep getting different values each time. So I'm going to show that in my demo video. So I created this function called CoinFlow. So this just returns a 1 or negative 1 uniformly at random. And I can run this quick function to just flip it 10 times. And you can see here I flipped the coin 10 times and I got 7 heads and 3 tails. Almost like my original example with the sign test. And you know, you can do that again and again and again. And so here what I'm doing here is I'm flipping the coin 10 times and then I'm multiplying my B minus A difference by those coin flips. So what this is doing is just randomly swapping the sign of those differences. So every coin flip that comes up heads will be a positive one and the sign will not be flipped. Every coin that comes up tails will be negative 1, and that will be multiplied by the difference, so the sign will be flipped to the opposite sign. So then you can see how you get different values for the difference, depending on how the coin flip comes out. And then you can take the means of those, and you get different values of the mean difference in these different triangles. And each one of these mean values represents a possible mean that you could have gotten if there was no association between the treatment and the measurement that you're applying. So that's the null hypothesis here. The null hypothesis is that there's no association between that treatment and that measurement value. And then we come up with a distribution for that null hypothesis by randomly changing the signs of values and computing the mean of the change to sign of values. So it's kind of like we're hallucinating on an alternate world when we get slightly different measurements, and that results in a different mean value. And then we can do this over 10,000 trials. So we can compute this mean, this mean, this mean, this mean, and then 9,996 more of these, and plot the distribution. And what we get is a distribution that looks like this. So it's not exactly a normal distribution. It has more weight in the middle than a normal distribution typically would. And that probably means it has lighter tails than a normal distribution typically would. It is centered around 0. And that's the expected result. What we're saying is that the null hypothesis, that there's no association between treatment and measurement, means that the null hypothesis is equivalent to there's no difference between the two systems. And that would mean that we should see 0 here at the center of the distribution. And then to compute a p-value, we can just look at how many of these values are greater than or equal to the original mean that we computed from the measurements that we have. So that mean was 0.214. So we just look at how much of this distribution is greater than 0.214, and that's our p-value. So in this case, we get a p-value of 0.0232. Now, you should see here that there's going to be some randomness in this. We can do 10,000 trials, but we're randomly flipping coins in each one of those trials, which means we're going to get a different mean in each one of those trials. The distribution is going to look slightly different in each one of those 10,000 trials. And so we could potentially get a different p-value every time we do this. So if I try this 3 separate times, I actually get 3 different p-values. All 3 of them are lower than the first one I got. they're all still pretty close to each other, so you could probably say that this result is significant if we're using the 0.05 value of significance. But we do have to be aware that now we have a distribution of possible p-values we could get just from using this data. And so it's not a very, the p-values aren't precise thing in this case. It's something that we're sampling from a distribution. And then my last line here is I'm describing a function to be able to do this randomization test for the problem. So I wrote the function, then I applied the function to the same two system results, and this time I got a p-value of 0.023. So that's our distribution again. And again, we're looking at all the values in that distribution that are greater than what we originally measured in our data, and that gives us our p-value of 0.023. And then the next test I want to talk about is another empirical distribution test. This one's called the bootstrap test. So this one also uses randomization, but it uses it in a very different way than the randomization test does. What the bootstrap test does is it will again take that column of differences, but we're not going to be flipping signs or anything like that in this case. What we're going to do instead is we're just going to sample from that set of 10 values within the sample with replacement. So that first column there, it represents one possible sample of those 10 values with replacement. The second column represents a possible sample with replacement. The third column represents a possible sample with replacement. And again, we can do this over and over and over again. We compute the mean in each one of those columns and then show the distribution of means. So to do that in R, we use the sample function. We say sample from B minus A, replace equals true. That means we're going to sample with replacement. And then you can see that when we sample with replacement, we get the same value repeated multiple times. Some of the values don't appear at all, and that's expected. And when we compute a mean, each time we're going to get a different value of the mean. Sometimes it'll be lower, sometimes it'll be a lot higher. And again, we can do this 10,000 times and plot a histogram. And you can see this one looks a little bit skinnier than the normal distribution. It probably has longer tails. So you're getting a very different distribution than what you got with the randomization test. And then for this particular test, to compute the p-value, you look at how many of these values are less than zero. So now we're expecting that things are going to be around the original value that we measured. So we're expecting that this distribution is going to be centered around 0.214. And what we're looking at is that tail of values that's less than zero. And if we're finding that there's a pretty small set of values less than zero, then we conclude significance. And in this case, we indeed get a very small p-value of 0.005. So again, I wrote the function here, and then I compare these two tests, or these two systems using the bootstrap test, and again, you get different p-values because there's randomness in the procedure. Okay, so those are five tests. I just wanted to quickly compare some of the Trek 7 submissions I talked about earlier. So I showed you earlier the three retrieval ones from UMass Amherst that were submitted to Trek 7. These were three different systems that use the same underlying retrieval engine. So by comparing them, we can test a hypothesis about whether one system added something that was an improvement on another system. So let's first look at the means of these three systems. So the means are relatively close to each other. The first one has a mean of 0.27, the second one 0.28, and the third one 0.25. So it's difficult to just look at these and say that definitely, 502 is better than the other two. We need some more evidence to be able to conclude that. definitively. So what I've done here is I've written out the test functions to compare all pairs of these three systems. So we'll compare 501 to 502, 501 to 503, and 502 to 503. And we'll look at the p-values. So for the Wilcoxon test, we get a p-value of 0.1995 for 501 versus 502. For 501 to 503, we get a p-value of 0.502. And for 502 and 503, we get a p-value of 0.005 or 0.006. So what that tells us is that by the Wilcoxon test, 501 and 502 are significantly better than 503, but 501 and 502 are not significantly different from each other. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean that they're equivalent? Does that mean that users are going to experience those two systems the same way? Does that mean that they're going to have the same value to users? No, it doesn't mean any of those things. We'll come back to that. So we can do that. We can do the same with the t-test. With the t-test, we get a p-value of 0.1, 0.008, and 0.001, respectively. So these p-values are lower than the Wilcoxon test p-values, and that's something you typically see. You often see that the t-test p-values are lower than Wilcoxon test values, and that's because the t-value or the t-test is throwing away less information, and so therefore has more power. More power means lower p-values. And we'll talk more about that. We can look at the randomization test p-values. Here, because this is doing 10,000 trials, it takes a little bit longer, but again, we get p-values that are pretty roughly in line with the t-test p-values. The only difference is this last one, comparing 503 to 502, is quite a bit smaller than the t-test p-value. And then for the bootstrap test, we do the same. And again, we get p-values that are pretty close in line with the randomization test and t-test p-values. So all four of these tests are giving us the same conclusions, basically. And that's nice. That helps us kind of have more confidence in that conclusion. But the p-values are different between all four of the tests, and so it's not really clear what that means exactly. With the bootstrap test, we get a lower p-value for the comparison between 501 and 502 than we get between any of the other tests. So maybe we should ask what that means exactly. But basically, the tests all support each other in terms of the difference between these two systems. So what I want to think about now is how we can understand tests better, compare tests, kind of draw larger conclusions about some of these tests. We can do this with track data. We can do this with real retrieval submission data. But a better way to do it is to generate random data, because if we generate random data, we can test all kinds of edge cases. We can test all kinds of things that we would never see in real search submission data or real recommender system data. So typically, a very simple way to do this is to just pick a sample size. So you can pick 10, 50, 100, 200, 10,000. This is actually a very good way to understand how the sample size affects test results. For that sample size, sample n values from some distribution that you want to look at. And a normal distribution is a very easy thing to do in this case. So then you have n values sample from a distribution, and you can run a test on those n values. So those are not like real evaluation result values. They're just n values. You can run a test on them and you can see what happens. And then you can repeat that over and over and over again and look for patterns. So one thing that's worth looking at, I think, is the idea of a p-value distribution. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to sample 50 values from a normal distribution, which has mean 0 and standard deviation 0. And so I get 50 values that look like this. And so this, these could look like differences between system. This could look like system comparisons. The only thing that makes them not look like system comparisons is that they're very precise. They're precise down to, I don't know, how many decimal places. and they're outside of that normal range of negative 1 to 1 that we would see when we look at differences between systems. But other than that, you know, there's, you can really kind of just go to the eyes basically on system differences. So if there's system differences, then we can run a t-test on them. And for this t-test, we got a p-value of 0.171. Now, I actually don't want to see all this information the t-test gives us. It gives us a lot of stuff, confidence intervals, t-values, degrees of freedom, sample mean, all this stuff. Right now, the only thing I care about is the p-value. So I'm going to subset this just to the p-value. And this time, I again sampled 50 values. These are 50 new values. And this time, I got a p-value of 0.367. So every time I sample 50 values, I'm going to get a different p-value. And so if I do that 10,000 times, then again, like I did before, I can look at the histogram of p-values. And what you see is that the histogram looks pretty flat. And we can make it look flatter if we run more trials. So what this histogram is showing is the distribution of p-values, and here you can see it's quite flat. So this is all p-values between 0 and 1. Basically, every p-value has roughly equal chance of being sampled. So what this shows is the distribution of p-values when the null hypothesis is true. So we're sampling values from this normal distribution with mean 0. That means we're simulating a case where we have no difference between two systems. We expect that mean to be 0. And then we're doing a test on those values that we sampled. And when we do that test, then we get a p-value anywhere from 0 to 1 with equal probability. And in particular, we should note that that means we get p-values of less than 0.05 with a 0.05 probability. So in this case, we are intentionally making the null hypothesis true. We're intentionally saying there's no difference between systems. And then in 5% of our tests, we're still finding some difference between systems. And so what that means is that we have a 5% error rate in the test. Now, we could also test a case where there is a difference between systems. We could say, what if the difference between systems was 0.5? Then what would our p-value distribution look like in that case? And what we're going to see now is that the distribution is going to be very skewed to 0. So with a distribution, when the difference between systems is 0.5, you're much, much, much more likely to see a p-value that's 0.05 or less. So now you have looks like about 90% chance of rejecting the null hypothesis in this case. But that means you have a 10% chance of not rejecting the null hypothesis. So you have a 10% chance of getting a p-value that's greater than 0.05, even though there is a difference between the two systems. So these are so this kind of shows the idea of the test error rates looking at it. The other thing I want to do is show how you can use the simulation data to compare two different tests. So here again, I'm going to sample 50 values from the normal distribution, and then calculate the Wilcoxon test p-value and the t-test p-value for those sample values. And here you can see that I got 0.52 for the Wilcoxon test and 0.39 for the t-test. And again, if I do that 10,000 times, then I can look at the correlation between the two. And it turns out the correlation between Wilcoxon test p-values and t-test p-values is very high, 0.97 correlation. I can look at a contingency table to see when they agree. And it turns out that they agree about a non-significant result 94% of the time. They agree about a significant result of 4% of the time. And then about the remaining 2% of the time, they disagree on whether the result is significant. So these two tests, even though they're making very different assumptions about the data, they're processing the data in different ways, they're losing different types of information, they agree with each other at a very high rate. And if you look at the plot, the scatter plot is actually quite, it's quite scattered. You can get a low Wilcoxon test p-value or a much higher t-test p-value. You can get a high Wilcoxon test p-value or a pretty low t-test p-value. But despite those differences, the agreement between the two tests is still quite high. So we can do that, we can compare the sign test and the Wilcoxon test, and again, you see a lot of scatter here, but the agreement is actually quite high if you look into the numbers. The sign test and the t-test, agreement is quite high, despite the scatter. Wilcoxon and t-test, we just saw, if you look at the randomization test and the t-test, they're almost exactly in agreement with each other. There's almost no difference between the two in terms of what they look about there. Values. And then the bootstrap test and the t-test are the same, almost no difference between their interpretation of data. So even though the p-values are differing a lot, the actual end result is very similar in all these cases. Now what you might ask is, how much of that is due to the fact that we were sampling from a normal distribution? Turn out that it could be quite a lot. So I'm going to change this distribution. And instead of looking at a normal distribution, I'm going to look at what's called the Cauchy distribution. And again, I'm going to use a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So the Cauchy distribution is fairly similar to a normal distribution. If you look at a Cauchy distribution and a normal distribution side by side, you may not be able to tell the difference. They both look like bell curves. The difference is that the Cauchy distribution has much longer tails and much fatter tails. And in fact, the Cauchy distribution has infinite variance, whereas the normal distribution has bounded variance. So this is kind of an extreme case of a different distribution. And I want to see what the Wilcoxon t-test agreement looks like in this extreme case. And you can see here now the correlation drops to 0.54 for this extreme case. You have much higher disagreement between the two tests, although they still agree a lot on which outcomes are not significant. But the total amount of disagreement rises to over 5%. And when you look at the scatter plot, you wouldn't think that there was any correlation between these things. I mean, well, you would see some correlation, but it looks like there's a huge amount of range for each value in terms of what they can take. So this distribution you're sampling from potentially matters quite a bit in these tests. And what that means practically is that null distribution, which was the binomial distribution for the sign test, the Wilcoxon distribution for the Wilcoxon test, the t distribution for the t test, the empirical distributions for the bootstrap test, and the randomization test. What we're assuming about those distributions can have a big effect or a big impact on what these tests tell us about the data. So if we're assuming that the data is distributed according to the t-test, or the t-distribution, like we are for the t-test, and it turns out the data is not distributed that way, then we could be completely wrong in our interpretation of p-value. If instead the data is actually distributed by a Cauchy distribution, if it's coming from these very, very long tails, and there's some chance that we're getting values that are 10 to the 9th, 10 to the 12th, things like that, then it's not clear at all that p-value is going to be. So one question we can ask is, how robust is the test to this distribution, to this underlying data distribution? And that's where we can get into theory, and that's where the theory tells us it's actually very robust. So in practice, in these simulations, you can plug in a lot of different distributions here, and we can show that the p-values are actually pretty consistent against that distribution. This Cauchy case is one extreme case where we see different p-values, but most distributions we could plug in there, we would see pretty consistent p-values. And there's theory that shows that, which I'm not going to show you, but there it is out there. Okay, so I want to I want to mention one last test. This is an important test, a very important test, pretty much, I would say, as important as the t-test in kind of the grand scheme of things in sciences in general. When we're doing these kinds of system comparisons, these kind of batch comparisons, we actually don't use ANOVA very much. You don't see ANOVA very much in this kind of systems-based information retrieval literature. You do see a lot more in the user study literature because it is important for user studies. But it turns out that it's going to be important for these kinds of system-based experiments as well, so I'm going to touch on it for a second here. So the purpose of the ANOVA is to compare the variance due to the treatment, or the variance in these measurements that we can ascribe to the treatment, to the variance in these measurements that we would ascribe to the query. So we have formulas to compute two different types of variance. Then we take the ratio of these two variances, that gives us an F statistic, and then we can look for that F statistic in an F distribution and determine whether the result is significant or not. When you have two systems like this, so the ANOVA test can compare three treatments, four treatments, five treatments. So in that sense, it's different from the other tests that we've looked at. All of those other tests are for two treatments only. ANOVA, we can look at more than two. But when we do look at just two treatments, it turns out that it's equivalent to a t-test. This F statistic is just the t statistic squared. So it's so the F distribution is like the square of the t distribution. The p-value would be identical to the t-test p-value. And so the ANOVA is just a generalization of the t-test. And it's generalized to allow comparison of more than just two treatments. So I just want to quickly use the ANOVA to compare the three system from before. So to set up an ANOVA MR, you need to set up a data frame. And that data frame is going to have all of the metric values on rows. It's going to have a system indicator in a column in that data frame, so that will be either A or B for that artificial data we're looking at. And it will have a topic indicator or an instance indicator, a sample indicator, and that will range from 1 to 10. So what I kind of want you to see within this data frame is that it kind of looks like a matrix that you might see in a machine learning problem. You have a value that you're trying to predict, and then you have features that you're trying to use to predict that value. And then to actually run the ANOVA, you set up an equation that says that I think that the metric value can be modeled as a function of the system indicator variable, and then there's some randomness due to the topic indicator. And I'm saying that there's that randomness because I'm treating that topic, that subtopics as a sample that I picked from some larger population, or I could have picked a different sample of 10, but I would still have the same two treatments that I'm looking at. So the AOV function will compute those two variances that I showed. We'll show the S statistic of 5.414, and then we can verify that that's the square of the T statistic that I showed earlier, and your p-value. In this case, it's actually double. It's twice the p-value because it's looking at both tails. For those UMass systems, for 501, 502, and 503, we set up the problem the same way. We have our data frame as the system indicator. This time there are three different values for that. There are 50 values for the topic indicator. And then once we have that data frame, we run the ANOVA. And we get an F value of 5.76 and a probability of 0.004. I'm sorry, a p-value of 0.004. So what does that p-value tell us? Well, we have three systems that we're comparing. In this case, the p-value means that there is a difference between at least one pair of those three systems. So the p-value says there's some difference between those three systems. It's not telling us which pair has the difference, but it's telling us that there is some difference in those three systems. Okay. So this is the summary of the first part. So these are the six most common tests seen in experimentation. There's a lot of other tests in the literature. Chi-squared is a very popular test. Excuse me. There's proportion tests. There's all kinds of variations on the ANOVA. There's the ANCOVA, MANOVA, MANCOVA. kinds of things. What they all have in common is that there is a underlying distribution. An underlying distribution may assume where the data came from. In the case of the non-parametric tests, that's a distribution that we obtained by transforming the data into some form that we can work with easily. That's the Psi test and the Wilcoxon test. In the case of a parametric test, like the t-test, we're estimating that distribution, we're creating that distribution that has parameters that are estimated from the data itself. And then for the empirical tests, we're just computing a distribution from the data itself. But regardless of how we're doing it, we need some distribution that we can look into. And then no matter what we do, no matter how we compute that distribution, no matter what we come up with, we get p-values that are pretty highly correlated. And we do see exceptions to that if we look at extreme cases like the Cauchy distribution. We've got another variance. But typically, you do see pretty high agreement between these tests. So what I kind of want to take away from this, I think one important thing to note here is that there is this variability in key values. So the p-value itself is a random variable. It's not a precise thing. There's no point in repeating in showing a p-value out to 8 significant digits or something like that, because depending on what sample of topics you get, depending on how you measure things, you're going to get different p-values. I want to point out the simplicity of these tests. So all 6 of these tests are taken from stats textbooks. They're really designed for the broadest possible application. They're designed to be used in the widest possible array of cases. And in that sense, they're very conservative tests. They're not meant to be... they're not necessarily meant to apply to every case that you can apply them to. And you can see that when we have to throw out data in some of these cases. If we have to throw out an instance for the Psi test or the Wilcoxon test because we cannot actually model it using the distribution for that test, it tells us there's something wrong with the test and the way we're applying it to the data. So they're simple, and that's good, but on the other hand, it's not clear that they're the right tests for what we're actually doing. And so I want to get that more into that in the second part of this talk, getting into fundamentals. So we have about 15 minutes to the break. I'm just going to try to cover some of this relatively quickly. This is kind of like some definitions I want to get through, so it's not the most immediate thing. Yes. Yes. So I'm going to talk a lot more about multiple comparisons in the next part of the talk, but we'll get to that. I would say my opinion is, what I want to show, I'll give you a preview. What I want to show is that if you can set up the multiple comparisons problem from scratch, you don't even need to worry about whether you should use A-level or R4. You can kind of work through the steps to see what is the distribution I should be using to compare these systems. Would I have like 10 systems I would compare? So I'm hoping that I can kind of show you how to think about these things. So you don't actually have to worry about those kinds of questions. Don't worry about what model to use. Just think about what's the problem you want to solve, and then how do you work through the steps to get to the solution as well. I do think in most cases the bootstrap distribution or the bootstrap test is perfectly fine. And in fact, I think that actually ties into my answer to your previous question, which is like, if you think about it in terms of, I have this statistical question I want to answer, like, how do I come up with the answer to that? It's often best to go to bootstrap methods or randomization methods, not worry about what assumptions am I making when using data. I was waiting for distributed and things like that. So even though I kind of qualify that as maybe it doesn't work in all cases, I do think in the majority of cases it's perfectly fine to use bootstrap methods. The only thing I would say is that it does require a lot of sampling, so it requires more computation power, it requires more time. T-testing is extremely fast thing to do. It's just a couple of quick operations. So in most cases, the t-test is going to give you the same result. So. It's hard to hear you, but I think you're asking about the confidence intervals and the difference between the confidence intervals and the p-values.
So I was saying that it's assumed that the estimate is fixed, or they could work off the deterministic process, right, to pick in the metrics and then to look at your test data, they could bootstrap, etc. What do you think of scenarios where your estimate depends on, say, some amount of randomness? Something like initialization, and the initialization parameters and algorithm networks or distribution trees. So when you have such models, how do you also take randomness in building an estimate?
Yeah, good question. So especially like personalized systems, now we have a lot of, there's like explore-exploit systems where there's usually going to be some randomness in how the results are actually presented. In an offline setting, you could run the algorithm multiple times, and you could get multiple results for the same query. Now, what I think you need to start thinking about in that case, though, is that you have one request, and you've run that one request, say, 10 times, or 25 times, or 50 times, to see the variation of the results you might get, and therefore see the differences in measurements. So now instead of having one request, one value, we have one request and 50 values. So. And so it becomes a different modeling question in that case. And what I would say is that then you need to set up the test in a different way. You could use an ANOVA for that. It's actually it's pretty easy to use an ANOVA in that case. What that would look like in an ANOVA is that instead of having just one row where you have a system and the topic ID, you might have 50 rows where you have the same two values for those things, but 50 different measurements for those. And that's called repeated measures, ANOVA.
It's working. Those measurements are not independent.
Right. They're not independent, but that's captured by the fact that they have the same two values for those two for the system at the time. Now, in practice, what you might end up having is you're not going to have exactly 50 50 measurements for every pair of things. You have a production system running. The user goes to that system. They have some requests. They get results. And then the same user comes and it's the exact same request at some other time, and they see slightly different results because of randomness, because of explore-exploit or something like that. And then you have two results for that request. And then for a different user, you might have four results for the same request. And for a different user, you have just one result for the same request. And then you have this issue where you have different sample sizes across these things. And then the ANOVA is probably not going to work as well in that case, and then you need to think about the deeper kind of modeling question. So I actually don't have an answer for that right now, but hopefully when I'm done with the tutorial, you'll sort of see some ways that you can think about that to solve that question. Any other questions? So I'm just going to briefly get started here on the fundamentals before we move on to the break. So I want to talk about some of the different testing paradigms that exist. So Ronald Fisher, the statistician, he came up with a randomization test. He had a very specific way of thinking about statistical significance testing. And his way of thinking about significance testing was opposed by Neumann and Pearson, who had a different way of thinking about it. These guys hated each other. They were constantly sniping at each other in the literature. They did not agree with each other at all. Although I think they probably have more in common than one in common. And then there's a sort of completely different testing paradigm, which is called the Bayesian hypothesis testing paradigm. And it's named after the Reverend Thomas Bayes, but really the person who did the most to build it to what we use today is a statistician named Harold Jeffries. So what are these tests really telling us? So we set up these tests as a comparison between a null hypothesis, or we set them up as a null hypothesis. So we might have a null hypothesis that the mean difference is zero, the difference between two systems is zero, or we might have a null hypothesis that the difference is less than or equal to zero, right? That one system is better than the other. And that null hypothesis, for that null hypothesis, we have the null distribution. That's the distribution that's assumed by the test. And that hypothesis plus that distribution is a model. That's saying the world could look like this. The world could look like we sample measurements from a binomial distribution, and those measurements are either plus one or minus one. And when we add them all up, we can see that the coin that generated them is either fair or not. So that's a model that tells us that everything in the world is dependent on coin flips, for example. And then when we compute the test statistic, that's summarizing the evidence that we have from the actual measurements that we took against the truth of that model. So if we've accumulated enough evidence from our measurements to show that that model is false, then we say that we reject the null hypothesis. So a significance test is a procedure. It's basically an algorithm. It takes the data, that's the measurement data that we have. It takes the null hypothesis that we care about, and it takes the procedure for computing the null distribution, which might just be the description of the distribution, or it might be a sampling procedure to come up with an empirical distribution. And it outputs a p-value. And then that p-value is the probability that you would have seen that same result, those same set of measurements, or more extreme measurements, if the null hypothesis were true. So it's saying if the world looks like the way it's modeled by our null hypothesis, then the probability that we see our data is this p-value. And then we use that kind of fuzzy contrapositive logic to say that if that probability is low, then we can reject the null hypothesis. Like if not y, then not x. So that's the procedure we typically use. Now what these three different paradigms view it as. For Fisher saw the p-value as the likelihood of the data under the null hypothesis. And he did not see it as something that you would generalize to reject a null hypothesis. He saw it as something that's a conclusion about a particular experiment that you did, and nothing more, nothing less. It's not something where you would do any kind of inference based on it. And I think there's good reason for Fisher saying that, because we have seen that there's so much variance in p-values. The kind of contrapositive logic that we use to reject the null hypothesis doesn't really work in that variance setting. But Neumann Pearson did want to generalize from a p-value of less than 0.05. They said that if the p-value is low, that means we can reject the null hypothesis as being unlikely to be true, and therefore we can make an inference about the population. We can make an inference about, say, a set of retrieval queries, or we can make an inference about a set of users that one recommender system or one search system is better than another one in the population. So they do not care about the p-value, they care about the inference that you get from the p-value. And in the Neumann-Pearson study, you can reject the null hypothesis or you can not reject the null hypothesis, but you would not accept an alternative hypothesis. You can only reject or not reject a null hypothesis. For the Bayesian paradigm, the idea of the Bayesian paradigm is that you can specify a bunch of different models and you can compare them all based on the data you have. So you can have your null hypothesis model, you can have five different alternatives that you think the world might look like, and then you can say, based on my data, which of these six things is most likely to actually represent the world. And you do that by computing posterior probabilities of hypotheses, and then the idea there is that you can update those posterior probabilities with new data that comes in and get better conclusions. I'm going to do one more slide, then I'm going to stop for the break. The next slide is, what are the tests not telling us? So these are kind of typical statements that you see about significance tests in published papers. And papers will say that the p-value of less than 0.05 means that there's a low probability that the results are due to chance. That's not really the case. That's not really what it's saying. It's saying that the results are not likely to have been generated given the null model. That's not the same as saying due to chance. It's not telling us anything about the reliability of the experiment. We can have a low p-value with a very poorly designed experiment. We can have low p-values with experiments that are not reproducible. It's not the probability that the null hypothesis is just true or false. You do see this misunderstanding from time to time. Some people say that a p-value of 0.03 means there's a 3% chance that the null hypothesis is true. That's not what it says. It says there's a 3% chance that the data was generated given the null hypothesis. But the null hypothesis could actually still have a quite high probability of being true in that case. And I'll show an example of that. We're not saying that the null hypothesis is false if the p-value is low. We might reject the null hypothesis, but we cannot decisively conclude that the null hypothesis is false. And vice versa, if the p-value is high, that does not mean that the null hypothesis is true. So I'm going to stop there for now. So please come back after the break and we'll talk more about these things and we'll get into some of the questions about multiple comparisons and about how to set up your own tests given what we know. Thank you. So what I'm going to do with this part, I'm going to go through some terms and definitions just to kind of get everybody on the same page in regards to some of the terminology used. And then I'm going to talk about some myths and misconceptions around the system type of tests. And then I'm going to talk about some ways that you can sort of use what you know about tests to solve your own problems, your own statistical problems. And then if we have time, I'll wrap up with some philosophical discussion. If we don't have time, then I'm very happy to have philosophical discussions with all of you during the conference. So very quickly, I showed you this slide before. We have our different retrieval systems or different recommender systems, whatever they are. Generally, they're called treatments. And the treatments are something that is applied to what we call the subjects. In search, the subjects are generally queries. In recommender systems, the subjects are usually users with some context attached to them. But the subjects are the thing that the treatments, the subjects are the thing that are sampled from some larger population to be treated, and then we measure the effect of the treatment on those subjects with the goal of determining which treatments are working the best on average. We can look at tests in different ways, so we can talk about single sample tests versus two sample tests. When I did a paired t-test, when I showed you those tests where I had one column of numbers and then another column of numbers, and then I subtracted the two columns to get one column of differences, that is a one-sample test. Basically, I just took one sample from the population, I computed the measures, and then I did a test on that one sample. The two-sample test comes into play when you have like an A-B test, for example, where you're sending some users to one treatment, other users to another treatment, and then you have one sample of users for the one treatment, a different sample for the second treatment, and then you have two separate samples that you have to talk about. We can also talk about paired tests versus unpaired tests. When I do that procedure where I subtract the two numbers to get one column of numbers, I'm doing a paired test in that case. I'm using the fact that I have matched pairs measurements on two different measurements on each subject, and using that to basically, what the effect of that basically is to subtract out some variance due to the subject and get a little more power. Unpaired tests are when you cannot do matched pairs. And so there's often a correspondence between a paired test and a one-sample test, and an unpaired test and a two-sample test. Those things are fairly highly correlated, although they're not exactly the same. We can also talk about one-tail tests versus two-tail tests. So when I show you the distributions of the test statistics, or the null distributions, so these distributions that I showed you earlier, when I said that we're looking at all the values that are less than zero in this distribution, we're looking at just one tail in this distribution. And so this is doing a one-tail test. We could also look at the other's tail. So we could define some threshold above which we're going to look at all the values greater than that threshold, as well as all the values less than zero. And then we're looking at both tails, and that's called a two-tail test. The reason for doing a two-tail test versus a one-tail test is essentially what the null hypothesis that you care about is. If the null hypothesis is an equality hypothesis, then you should do a two-tail test. Because if the equality is not the case, then it could be a positive difference or it could be a negative difference. You don't know which one a priori, so you just look at one. You would do a one-tail test when you do care about the sign of the difference. So if you think your sign is a positive difference, then you could do a one-tail test on the positive side of the distribution, and that would give you a p-value for that. So you generally get a higher p-value from a one-tail test. So one-tail tests are less conservative in how they give out single facts. So we talked a little bit about parametric versus non-parametric tests. We talked about test statistics. So for example, when you compute the t-statistic using the mean and the standard deviation computed from the data, you're computing a test statistic for a parametric distribution. And the parameter there that you're estimating is the variance parameter for the t-test. For the Wilcoxon test, the test statistic is that sum of rank values, and that's a non-parametric test because it has no parameters that you have to estimate from the data. It's just that value, and so. And then the test statistic has a confidence interval, and that's basically the range of values that that test statistic could take on if you had sampled other topic sets or other sample sets, other subject sets to do the experiment on. So I haven't talked a lot about confidence intervals. Confidence intervals are very important in statistical testing and in statistical reporting. I have not talked about them a lot. I guess what I'll do, just to make sure I do cover them a little bit, is to show you how these different tests that I was doing in R report confidence intervals. So for our two-sample t-test, when you run the two-sample t-test, it computes a mean, it computes a standard deviation, it computes a p-value, test statistic, and then it also computes a 95% confidence interval. You can see that there. So the 95% confidence interval says that the mean could be anywhere between -0.04 and infinity in this case. Now this is interesting because typically, when we look at metrics in search or recommender systems, we're looking at metrics that have values between 0 and 1. So it doesn't actually make sense to say that infinity is in the confidence interval of the difference in metric values. And that shows you another possible issue with these tests. This one is more reasonable. In the binomial test, the confidence interval does go up to 1. So I'm not going to say much about confidence intervals other than that they are reported by statistical packages and you should report them in the papers when possible. Other than that, I'm not going to say too much. In terms of definitions, this is probably the most important slide. These are some of the most important concepts so you understand with significance tests. So sample size is it's a very simple concept. It's the number of subjects that you have in the experiment. And these are generally assumed to be sampled from some larger population, sampled independently. The effect size is a measure of the difference between the two treatments, which is meant to be independent of the sample size. So if you recall the t-test, when we compute the t-statistic for the t-test, we use the mean, the variance, and the sample size to compute that test statistic. So that test statistic is not independent of the sample size. It's a function of the sample size. And the way it's computed, by multiplying times the square root of the sample size, as you get a larger sample size, you get a larger test statistic. The effect size is supposed to be something that is the same no matter how many samples you have in the experiment. And typically, the effect size is a statistic, and it's a statistic that's defined against the null distribution for the test. So a simple way to think of an effect size is like the magnitude of the difference between the two treatments. Another way to think of it is like a percent difference between two treatments. So those are two things that we very commonly report in research papers or in presentations. But the actual definition of the effect size depends on what test you're looking at and what kind of experiment is going to set up. Back over to I'm only going to talk about the effect size for the t-test because that's the easiest case to demonstrate. So the way the effect size is defined for the t-test is it's defined as the mean, at least this is for the paired t-test, it's defined as the mean between the mean of the differences divided by the standard deviation of the differences. So it is, in fact, exactly like the test statistic, but without the multiplication of the square root of the sample size. The effect size for this artificial data we created was 0.74. Now, that number has no meaning in and of itself. It's kind of a scaleless measurement, or a scaleless number. It's really impossible to say 1.74 means in some like wider context. But typically, if you're working with a product, for example, you're working with some like a web app or something like that, you have some understanding of your users, you have some understanding of what effect size is needed for the users to notice anything is different, and those are the kinds of effect sizes you want to look for in your experience. So effect size actually turns out to be a pretty fundamental concept, and you want to think about what effect size you want to see in the experiment before you actually start doing anything else in the experiment. And the reason for that is that, I'll show you. The reason for that is because the effect size is independent of the sample size, you can use the effect size to figure out what kind of sample you need in order to have a high power experiment. So what I'm showing here is, for this artificial data I showed you earlier, we have an effect size of 0.7350. And now, if we have a sample of 10 subjects, like we did in that case, we would have a t-statistic of 2.33. So that's exactly what I showed you on that slide earlier. But if we had that same effect size, and we had 50 samples instead of 10 samples, we would have a t-statistic of 5.2. And if we had 100 samples instead of 10 samples, we would have a t-statistic of 7.36. If we had 1,000 samples, we would have a t-statistic of 23.27. So what you can see is that the t-statistic depends very heavily on the number of samples you have. Now, what you might have noticed when I showed you the t-distribution is that a value, a cutoff of roughly 2 is enough to be significant. So what this shows you is as the sample size increases, your p-value, or your t-statistic is going to get farther and farther away from 2. So it's going to go farther and farther along that x-axis, which means when you look at the area under the distribution, you're looking at smaller and smaller and smaller amount of area. And that means your p-value is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And that's what this will show. But this compares the threshold needed to have a p-value of less than 0.05 to the t-statistic that's based solely on the sample size. And what this is showing you is that you're more and more likely where you get smaller and smaller p-values just by having a larger and larger sample. So this is an extremely important thing to understand. So the critical value is where you, it's the cutoff for saying that you have a significant result. And it's directly related to the p, it's directly related to the cutoff that you want for the p-value. So if I have a p-value cutoff of 0.05 or significance cutoff of 0.05, I can find where in my curve I get an area of 0.05, I can see what x value that is, and that's my critical value for the 0.05 significance level. Then I can determine significance by comparing the effect size times the square root of the sample size to the critical value. If that quantity is greater than the critical value, then I say I have a significant result. So you can see how much that depends on the size, the sample size, to find significance. Basically, what I'm saying is that you can always find a significant result just by getting a larger and larger and larger sample. I'll talk about this more in a little bit, but the sample size is an extremely important function in whether you get a significant result or not, and it's something that's very important to keep in mind. So let me just do another quick demo here. So let's say instead of this 0.74 effect size, let's suppose that we have an effect size of 0.1. So that would be considered a relatively small effect size. So now if we have an effect size of 0.1, when we have 10 samples, we have a t-statistic of 0.32. That's not going to be enough to reject a null hypothesis. If we have 50 samples, we have a t-statistic of 0.707. It's still not enough. 100 samples, t statistic of 1, still not enough. And when we get to 1,000 samples, our t statistic is 3.16, and that would be enough to reject a null hypothesis in that case. Now, you can go arbitrarily low with your effect size. When we go to 0.01, then 1,000 samples is not enough to reject. But if we go up to 100,000 samples, then we get our t-statistic that's large enough to reject. So now I work at Spotify. At Spotify, it's very easy for us to get 100,000 samples in an experiment. We have millions of active users every day, so if we just take one day's worth of data, we easily have 100,000 samples. And so what does that mean? It means we can detect significance on very, very small effect sizes. So we really need to think about whether a 0.01 effect size is meaningful for our users when we start an experiment. And in fact, that should be the first question you think about when we consider deploying an experiment. What is the effect size that's meaningful for our users? And then what is the sample size that we need to detect significance for that effect size? We talk a lot about variance. There's total variance, there's within group variance, there's between group variance. There's all these equations for computing variance. It's not really worth memorizing lots of variance equations, but it's kind of important to understand the concept and be able to talk about different kinds of variances. And the reason we want to talk about variance is because we can talk about variance due to some factor in the experiment. So we can talk about the variance due to the subjects, we can talk about variance due to the treatments. If our treatments are composed of multiple components, we can talk about the variance due to one component versus the variance due to another component. We can talk about the variance due to the interaction between components. And these are all things that are important for understanding how treatments are actually affecting the treatments. It's also important to understand that p-values have distributions. So I showed you some p-value distributions earlier. And I showed you specifically the case where if the null hypothesis is true, then the p-value has that uniform distribution. And your probability of seeing a p-value that's less than 0.05 is actually 0.05 if the null hypothesis is true. But when the null hypothesis is not true, then the p-value distribution depends very much on the effect size and the sample size. And those are the two quantities that really determine what the p-value distribution is. So again, it's those two quantities that are going to determine the likelihood that you get a significant p-value. So I mentioned this earlier as one of the things that p-values are not telling us. So I said a high p-value does not mean that the null hypothesis is true. And so I want to show a specific example of this. So let's say we do an experiment. We take some measurements and we see a mean average difference of 0.02 with a standard deviation of 0.16 with 50 samples. And this is a pretty typical experiment for an information retrieval search offline setting. These are the kinds of numbers that we see a lot. If you plug these numbers into a t-test, we would not get a significant result. We would get a p-value of 0.2. So that means if the null hypothesis is true, then the probability of getting this data from the experiment would be about 0.2. But if the null hypothesis is not true, and what you've observed in the data is actually what the world looks like. So if the actual mean was 0.02, and if the actual standard deviation in any given sample of 50 you took was 0.6, then it would be possible to get a significant result with this sample size. So you would get a significant result given these parameters about 14% of the time. So one thing this is saying, first of all, is that the sample size is too low to detect this effect with a high probability. So this is what we would call an underpowered experiment. There is an effect, if we assume, or there could be an effect, and if there is that effect, then there is a chance we would find it, but it would be a relatively small probability. But the other thing we can do is say, let's say we took these measurements, let's make that our alternate hypothesis. Let's say our null hypothesis is that the difference is zero, but our alternate hypothesis is that the difference is actually what we saw in our measurements. If that's the case, then what is the probability that the null hypothesis is true, given that we saw a p-value of less than 0.03? So we can use Bayes' rule to compute this. We're going now to, excuse me, a very, very light version of the Bayesian framework. Bayes' rule says that if we want to know the posterior probability of this null hypothesis being true, then we look at the a priori probability of getting the p-value of less than 0.05, given that the null hypothesis is true, times a priori value of the probability of the null hypothesis being true, and then we divide that by the total likelihood between the two hypotheses. So we know this quantity. Because H0 is our null hypothesis, we know that our error rate is 0.05, so we know what that is. The test is defined that way. We have this quantity, the probability that p-value is less than 0.05 given the alternate hypothesis. We have this from the experiment that we did, or from the analysis that we did, and we have that at 0.14. We can assume in the absence of any other information that our two hypotheses are equally likely to be true. And then once we have those four quantities, we just plug in all the values, and we get that our probability of null hypothesis being true, even though we have a p-value of less than 0.05, is 0.27. So even though we have a small p-value, even though we could get a p-value small enough to reject the null hypothesis, there could still be a 27% chance that null hypothesis is actually true. So this is another way of saying that the small p-value does not mean that the null hypothesis has a small probability of being true. They're not related directly in that way. And then finally, I want to talk about accuracy and power. So these are two ways of evaluating the test. And basically, you can think of these kind of in a contingency table, just like you would see in a classification problem in machine learning. So you had your null hypothesis. Your null hypothesis is either true or false. You had your test result. Your test result is either that the p-value is low enough to reject the null hypothesis, or the p-value is not low enough to reject the null hypothesis. And if the null hypothesis is true and you did not reject it, then that means you made the right decision. That's a true positive. And your accuracy rate is your true positive rate. And that's 1 minus alpha, where alpha is the cutoff for significance. So with the 0.05 threshold, your accuracy rate would be 0.95 for the test. So accuracy is only for when the null hypothesis is true. When the null hypothesis is false, then we want to look at our rate of correctly rejecting the null hypothesis. So if it's false, we want to have a p-value that's small enough to reject it. And then in that case, we're talking about the power of the test. For the power of the test, those are true negatives, I guess. Those are the cases where the H0 is false and we reject it. And we call that we use beta to represent the error rate there, and 1 minus beta to represent the power of the test. So every test has an accuracy and a power, and then the accuracy errors are also called type 1 errors, and the power errors are called type 2 errors. And those are your true positive, or sorry, your false positive rates and your false negative rates. So I want to combine a couple things I mentioned up to this point. So when I showed you the ANOVA, I showed you the table that kind of looked like it had a value and features, and you're kind of saying that the value is the function of the features, so it kind of looks like you're fitting some kind of model to the data. It kind of looks like a machine learning problem. We're looking at a contingency table, it looks like a classification problem. It kind of looks like a machine learning problem. And it turns out, really, the way we use statistical testing in research and in development, we're essentially using it as a binary classifier. We're doing essentially the same thing we do in machine learning. We fit a model, and we use it to make a prediction, and then we do something with that prediction. We take some action based on that prediction. So just like a classifier learns to model the data, in that case, the class is modeled as a function of features. Our statistical test is modeling on measurement data as a function of features as well. So it's modeling measurements. It's learning a model of the measurement data as a function of these features, which are very simple features that I've shown you so far. But then if we understand that, we can potentially do much more complicated things. Now, the one difference between statistical tests and classifiers is that there is not really a ground truth for statistical tests. We don't really know if the null hypothesis is true or not. Although I'm going to walk that statement back in a few slides. But in general, that's kind of the one big difference. So if a statistical test is basically a binary classifier, then what is the model that we're using? Well, it turns out that when you look at an ANOVA, you look at a t-test, you're basically doing a linear regression. When you do these tests, you're basically fitting a linear regression model, and then you're looking essentially at the system effect parameter, the beta parameter, and you're doing inference on that parameter. And so this is something that is not clear at all when you actually use these things. If you use a t-test, you have no idea that you're actually in the background fitting a linear regression model and then doing inference on linear regression parameters. But that's actually what's happening when you do the test. And that should actually raise a lot of questions in your mind. For one thing, we know that linear regression, the y value of linear regression is considered to be unbounded. It can range from negative infinity to infinity. We know that our metric values we usually care about are between 0 and 1. So it doesn't make sense to model a value between 0 and 1 using this linear regression model that's mapping values to make it from negative infinity to positive infinity. The model is linear. can we really say that we know that there's a linear effect? Like, let's say we look at a system parameter here, for example. I should explain what these parameters are. So yij is the measurement value of the treatment of the subject. So that's a specific measurement of a treatment subject we take. The mu parameter in the linear regression setting, that's the intercept of the model. In this experimentation setting, it represents kind of a baseline a baseline measurement that, based on the sample that you have, if that sample generalizes to the entire population, just averaging over that sample gives you the population measurement. And then there's an additive topic effect or subject effect, and this is how much that value increases or decreases based on the identity of the subject. And that's just based on that ID number that we have in the data. So, you know, the first question we could ask is that actually an additive effect? Like, if we just know the ID, is it always going to be adding some value or measurement to our baseline? My guess is probably not, but that's the assumption we're making here. The beta represents the system effect. And again, this is being modeled as an additive linear effect. And we should think about, again, is that the case? Is it the case that if we create a new system, that system is an additive over, say, another system that we're comparing to? And then finally, we want to lose some random error in this. So we're saying that, again, I want to go back to what I said before. When we build two systems and we compare them, there's often not really any randomness in there. Or when there is randomness, it's often very controlled randomness. But let's say we take a traditional system that has no randomness at all, it's completely deterministic. Why are we modeling random error when we model the metric values? The reason we're doing that is because we know that there are things that we have not captured in these three other variables. We know that there are effects on the data that we're not modeling, and therefore we're just kind of lumping them into this random effect variable. So the model has a lot of problems, actually. And you would never think about these problems if you just go and do a t-test. But every time you do a t-test, you are repeating. You are encountering these problems. You're dealing with these problems. Or I guess maybe it's more accurate to say you're sweeping these problems under the rug and pretending that they don't exist. So again, modeling evaluation, ANOVA and t-test are linear regression models. You can get the exact same result by fitting this linear regression model using ordinary least squares. You could compare beta values that come out of that. And then the OLS estimator for one of those beta variables is exactly equivalent to the mean effectiveness of treatment I. The error variable is assumed to have a normal distribution with variance sigma squared. And then the inference procedure uses those two quantities and ignores everything else. But all of that other stuff is in there in the model, and it's affecting the values of beta, the values of standard deviation. Now this is the case for the ANOVA and the t-test, but it's also the case that the Wilcoxon test is based on some model, the sign test is based on the model, the bootstrap test and randomization test, even though we're not specifying a distribution, there's still a model that we're assuming those tests. So no matter what test we do, we're assuming some model. And almost all those models we're assuming are additive and linear, even if they don't make specific assumptions about the distribution of error rates or anything. We are still very often assuming linearity and additivity, and we should probably think about whether those are assumptions that we actually want to be. So I'm going to close this section with one of my favorite quotes from the statistician George Box. You may have heard this one. It's starting to become very popular. I think when I first made these slides in 2013, I don't think very many people have heard this before. But George Box said, "All models are wrong, but some are useful." Right? And the idea there is that any way that we have of modeling the real world, it's going to be wrong with some value. But even if the model is wrong, it could be useful in some contexts. In this case, this t-test model or this regression model is wrong for the kind of evaluation data we have for lots of different reasons. But maybe it's useful. You know, you can think about this with language data as well. Often, very often, when we model language data, we model terms as independent. That's obviously a wrong model, but it turns out to be a very useful model for a lot of search things people want to actually do in data. But what you really need to understand is, how is the model wrong? Are the ways that it's wrong really affecting the conclusions that we draw from the model? And if so, how can we fix those things that are wrong about the model? How can we improve the model and make it more useful in the future? So for the next part of this talk, I'm going to talk about some of the myths and misconceptions around significance testing. I'll try to go through this fairly fast. We have about 45 minutes left. So why do we do significance testing? So I said before, you know, we often see tables of numbers where we have a 0.55 and a 0.56 and a 0.57. And if we don't do significance tests of those kinds of differences, we don't really know if they're meaningful or not. So they lend some rigor to the experimentation that we're doing. We very often see differences in offline testing in academia. We see differences of less than 5% very frequently. In industry, we see differences that are less than 1%, even differences less than 0.5%. So the differences we see in industry are actually very small. And in order to understand those differences, we do need some kind of statistical procedure. But the tests that we're using, I think a lot of us don't understand very well. We don't necessarily understand how to interpret the p-value. Different people have very different interpretations of it, and a lot of those interpretations are not correct. It's also the case that the p-values can be very easily manipulated. And this is even true if you as a researcher are completely honest, and you as a researcher are completely rigorous in how you set up your experiments, you can still unintentionally manipulate your p-values and get p-values that are inaccurate for the experiment being done. And we know about some of this in industry, in our A-B testing that we do. We know how these kinds of manipulations can happen unintentionally. I think in academia, when I was in academia before I joined Spotify, I was not so aware of some of these manipulations. So I think, you know, the thing to understand is that these tests that we're using are not, you know, fundamentally, they're no more rigorous than any other kind of AI or ML approach. We're using these tests to solve a problem, and that's the problem of understanding whether small differences are meaningful. But we should always remember that for solving that problem, they're just as good as any kind of machine learning approach or meta-class any other problem. They do have an incredibly deep theoretical basis. People have been thinking about these things for over 100 years now. And so there are books written about significance tests that talk about go into very deep theory. But in terms of their actual use, it depends very much on the problem you're trying to solve and the specific nature of the data that you have and the setting that you're working. So I'm going to start with the first myth, which I consider to be the most important myth, which is that the null model, the null hypothesis plus the null distribution is a realistic model of the world. In most cases that we apply these things in computer science, the null hypothesis is a priori false. We already know that the null hypothesis is not true. And we're just doing a test to see if our experiment can actually confirm that. And how do we know that the null hypothesis is not true a priori? It's because we designed our system specifically to be different from the baseline that we're testing. If we know the system is different because we designed it that way. So there should be no way to say that the mean is zero, as long as we don't have a serious bug in our implementation. So what it comes down to then is, as I showed you before, the only question is how big of a sample size do you need in order to reject that null hypothesis? If I'm right, and you're free to disagree with me if you want, but if I'm right, and if every time we go into an experiment, it's already the case that the null hypothesis is false, then that means that the effect size is already non-zero. And no matter how small it is, if it's non-zero, then we can find a sample size that's large enough to reject the null hypothesis. And then when you get into, again, I'll use Spotify as an example, we can get very, very large samples very, very easily. And so it's very easy for us to reject. So if the null hypothesis is always false, then why are we even bothering with these tests? It really comes down to, again, looking at the effect size and understanding what effect size is. And that's why I say that's really the most important thing with these tests. You have to have a good idea of what effect size matters before you go into a test. Because you can reject any effect size, or you can reject an experiment based on any effect size. But if you know what effect size you're looking for, then you can specifically design your test to look for that effect size, and not effect sizes that are much smaller than that. And that's how you get a more meaningful result from the significance test. A myth, I've already touched on this, but rejecting the null hypothesis means that the null hypothesis is false. This is false because there are tons of ways that we can reject a null hypothesis that have nothing to do with whether it's true or not. Now, you know what? I already said that the null hypothesis is always false. So, you know, don't take this slide too seriously. But there may be cases, like for example, clinical trials, where a treatment really does have no effect. And in that case, the null hypothesis really is false. There could still be reasons that null hypothesis could be rejected. And it could be due to bias in sample, it could be due to violations of test modeling assumptions, it could be due to a failure to model some important sources of variance, it could be due to overfitting. There's a lot of reasons that have nothing to do with the actual truth of HCR. So we shouldn't put too much stock in actually rejecting the null hypothesis. Again, I want to go back to the idea of effect size. What we should be talking about is the experiment powerful enough to reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis at the effect size that we care about for the experiment? And again, that comes back to really understanding the users of your systems and what the users care about when you're using your system. This is a myth. This is a myth that's sometimes a myth, sometimes not a myth. The myth is that test assumptions are important. If you had that t-test, which is based on linear regression, there's a number of assumptions that is making, which we talked about. So we're talking about the assumption that the measurements are unbounded. We're talking about the linearity and the additivity assumptions. There's this assumption called homoscedasticity, and that's a really fancy way of referring to variance being uniform over treatments. So what that means is that every treatment has the same variance within that treatment. And that's an assumption that is almost surely false when we're looking at the kinds of metrics that we look at in search and recommendation. We have the normality of errors as an assumption. And all of these assumptions are false. But that doesn't mean that the test is automatically invalid. It doesn't mean that the test results are invalid. And in fact, we can actually test these assumptions. We can use simulation to say, to kind of, you know, push on these assumptions, interrogate these assumptions, and say, if, for example, we can say, if homoscedasticity is false, how far away do we have to get from uniform variance before we actually see an effect in the t-test? We can do that through simulation. From the procedures I've been showing you. So I have a paper from 2012 where I set up some experiments, I set up some simulations to test each one of these assumptions in the t-test. And what I found is that in each one of these cases, you can get pretty far away from what the assumption is before you actually see any false results or you see any deviation from what's expected in the t-test. So for the t-test, these assumptions are not that important. They only become important when you're getting really far away. Like, for example, normality of errors, not that important. Unless your errors are coming from a Cauchy distribution, if you have variance, then it becomes important. The fact that y is unbounded is not that important as an assumption, unless it's combined with normality of errors not being true, and then you could get really far away. But let's say we think the t-test assumptions are false, and therefore, why don't we just use a different test? We always have to keep in mind that every test we could use is based on some model, and every model is false in some way. If we can't model everything, it can affect our results, especially when we're talking about systems that are as complex as search systems and recommendation systems. There are so many things that go into those systems that it's impossible to model every single factor that could have an influence on the results. So no matter how we model them, we're going to be modeling something false. So the trade-off to think about is not necessarily about whether the assumptions are true or not, but how many assumptions you're making versus how much power you want to have in the test versus how many significant results you're going to get. If you're making fewer assumptions, you're typically going to have less power in the experiment. So your experiment is going to be underpowered to detect the effect size that you want to detect. And that means you're going to get fewer significant results. On the other hand, often having more assumptions gives you more power in your test, and that gives you more significant results. So the t-test is popular because it's a powerful test. It does make quite a few assumptions, but it's very robust to violations of those assumptions. And computationally, it's an extremely easy thing to do. You just compute a mean, standard deviation, and then look up a value of distribution. Right, so this is about the intrinsic meaning of p-values. So when we take the p-value to be a p-value of less than 0.05 to be a gold standard of proof against a null hypothesis, we have to keep in mind that p-value came out of a model, and that model is wrong, as always. And that 0.05 also, it's just an arbitrary value. There's really no reason for using it other than that's what other people do. And that's really, it really arose as kind of a convention that people used without really thinking too much about it. And of course, you can use other cutoffs. You can use a 0.01 cutoff or a 0.1 cutoff, a 0.001 cutoff, things like that. But whatever value you pick is essentially arbitrary. The meaning that we give to a p-value is completely extrinsic. It's a meaning that's granted by the community of scientists, maybe of the community of developers, but the p-value by itself doesn't have any meaning. The reason is because the p-value has that distribution. The p-value is sampled from a distribution, and that distribution depends on the choices that you make in the experiment. It depends on what treatments you're actually testing. It depends on your subject population. It depends on the model you're using, the test you're using. So the p-value cannot be an exact reflection of the real world. And again, I keep restating this, but the real gold standard is the users. What's the effect on the users? What effect do the users care about? And how do we create a test that's best designed to capture that effect and find significance with that effect? The idea that lower p-values are better, you'll see papers that have a p-value of 0.02 and a p-value of 0.04 and say that 0.02 one is more significant than 0.04. And it's not really an appropriate way of comparing p-values. A p-value from one experiment and a p-value from another experiment are not really comparable quantities because they're coming from different distributions. So you can't really directly compare them and say that one is better than the other. And again, the reason for that is that the p-value sampled from this distribution is conditional on the inputs that go into fitting that model for the test. And those inputs are differing between different tests, different experiments. And so if the inputs are differing, the distribution is different, and therefore the p-values are coming out of that directly. So I want to talk a little bit about this problem. This is called the multiple comparisons problem. So the myth, I've stated the myth as running many tests is an okay thing to do. So a lot of the time what we do in search and recommendation is we have a system, we have an idea to make that system better, so we implement that idea, and then we do a test. We compare those two systems. And if that test is significant, then we might say, okay, let's start writing a paper. If it's not significant, then we go back to step one. We do another modification, we do another test, and we keep looping like this. So we should ask ourselves, how many tests does it take to get to that endpoint of significance? Let's say every modification we do to our system actually has no effect on the system. And you know, again, ignore what I said before about there never being no effect. Just pretend that there could be no effect. And let's say everything we do has no effect. How long is it going to take before we get a significant result, despite the fact that nothing we've done has had any effect at all? And we can formulate that as a probability. We can say, what's the probability that the nth experiment gives a significant result, given m prior experiments that have lacked the power to reject the null hypothesis? Or what's the probability that we have at least one significant result, given m experiments that are lacking power to reject the null hypothesis? And it's actually pretty simple to work out the math for this. So we can decompose this as the probability that we have one significant result given m experiments, plus two significant results given m experiments, plus three, plus four, plus five, et cetera. And that's equal to the probability that we have no significant results given m experiments. That's one minus that probability. And then we know the probability that we have a non-significant result for one experiment. That's alpha. That's our, you know, that's our test experiment, our test accuracy. So the probability that we have that for m experiments is just 1 minus alpha to the nth power. And so we subtract that from 1, and that's our probability of getting at least one significant result after m experiments. The math is pretty simple, but you can simulate it and you'll get the same result. And the result looks like this. The greater the number of experiments you do that are underpowered to reject the null hypothesis, the greater the probability that you see of getting a falsely significant result. And in particular, if you're looking at the 0.05 cutoff, which is this line, if you just do 10 experiments, and for us in computer science, it's very easy for us to do 10 experiments. I shouldn't say very easy, it really depends on the models you're using and things like that. But in many cases, it can be very easy to do 10 experiments. If you do 10 experiments that are underpowered to find to reject your null hypothesis, you still have a 40% chance of rejecting a null hypothesis at least once. So you have a 40% chance of a false positive if you do 10 experiments. If you do 50 experiments, your chance of a false positive goes all the way up to over 90%. And once you're doing 100 experiments, you pretty much have a guaranteed chance of one false positive. So just by doing lots and lots of experiments, you increase your chance of getting false significant results. And you could think, like, what's the effect of that? The effect of that is that you have a much greater chance of getting a paper published that shows a significant result, but that when somebody goes and tries to reproduce, they won't be able to reproduce because that significant result was just due to the fact that you did a whole bunch of experiments. I'm going to come back to this in a second, but I want to summarize this section. So we're taught to use these tests in certain ways, and typically we get them from textbooks, we get them from stats textbooks. The stats textbooks, as I said before, are designed, they're presenting the tests that are the simplest possible tests that are applicable to the widest set of scenarios. And we're using them unmodified from those forms, from those textbook forms. We don't really reflect on them very much. We just want to get that significant result so we can put that asterisk in our paper, or so we can deploy a system and say that we deployed something. So these misconceptions propagate, and huge problems like the multiple comparisons problem go unaddressed. And the result is, for example, you have this paper from the Biomedical Sciences. The title of the paper is, Most Published Results Are Wrong. And he basically goes through this logic to show that actually, because of multiple comparisons, because of underpowered tests, things like that, most of the results that have been published in the Biomedical Sciences have a very high chance of reporting false significant. And it's likely that it's the same in computer science as well. and so that's something we should think about. So for this section, I want to talk about some of the applications of things we can do if we think about these tests in a careful way. So what is a significance test? So we've seen a significance test consists of four things. There's the null hypothesis, there's a test statistic, there's a null distribution for that test statistic, and then there's a critical value in that null distribution. If you're able to come up with those four things, then you've come up with a test. You come up with a statistical test. You don't have to come up with something that's in the textbooks. You don't have to come up with something that Fisher thought about 100 years ago. You can come up with the problem that's most appropriate for the problem that you're trying to solve. So why would we bother doing that? Well, I hope from some of the stuff I've been talking about before, I've convinced you that it's worth thinking about at least. But if we look at search or recommendation systems specifically, there's tons of variance, there's tons of sources of variance, there's tons of things that can affect our measurements that we don't model in our tests. That if we did model, we might get very different conclusions about differences between treatments. And so these are some examples. Assessor error, assessor disagreement, missing relevant instructions, total numbers of relevant documents, topic types, task types, the properties of the corpus, properties of the catalog that we're recommending things from, the specific properties of the effectiveness measures you're looking at, the metrics, low-level system features or components of the systems that can vary. There are, you can look in the literature, you can find individual papers about individual items in this list, but I don't think there is any work that takes all these things and says, here's a really good model for understanding experimentation in a model, or in search or recommendation systems. It takes into account all these possible sources of variance and allows you to answer questions based on all of them. As I showed you, the test models, the models behind things like ANOVA and T-test are actually accounting for very little of the sources of variance that can affect the measurements. They account for the treatment effect, the subject effect, and that's it. Everything else is ignored by those models. So it may be the case that if we could account for more than just those things, we might have results that are more believable. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about how we can apply this kind of thinking to the multiple comparisons problem. So there's a lot of literature on this problem. And the literature basically says that if you're doing M tests, okay, so let's say you have M systems you're comparing. And the simplest thing to do for those M systems is compare every pair of those systems. So you can do a t-test on system 1 and 2, t-test on 2 and 3, t-test on 1 and 3, t-test on 3 and 4. So, but if you're doing that with those M systems, then you're doing an order of M squared tests for those M systems. And if you're doing order of M squared tests, then your chance of getting a false result is increasing very fast. So what the literature says is that we should adjust the test results for the fact that we've done that many tests. And what that basically amounts to in most cases is doing some adjustment of the p-value, making the p-value higher to reflect the number of tests that you did in that experiment. So the Bonferroni correction that Shane mentioned earlier is kind of the simplest thing you can do. The Bonferroni correction basically takes a p-value and it adjusts it by that the equation I showed you earlier, one minus alpha to the nth power. And what that has the effect of doing is exponentially increasing the p-value based on how many experiments you did. It's a very, very conservative, very coarse correction to do. But if you're really worried about multiple comparisons, then it sets a very, very high threshold for finding this. There's Tukey's honest significant differences, which is, I think, my favorite approach, which I'll talk about a little bit more. There are approaches based on multivariate t-tests, which get very complicated. I don't actually want to pick one of these approaches. I don't want to say this approach is the best approach. What I want to try to do is reason from principles and say, here's the statistical problem we're trying to solve. how can we solve it given the tools that we have? So we should think first about what is the actual null hypothesis. What was the null hypothesis that we're trying to investigate? So that null hypothesis, we're doing all these comparative comparisons. So the null hypothesis is basically that system 1 and system 2 are the same, system 2 and system 3 are the same, system 3 and system 4 are the same, system 1 and 3 are the same, 1 and 4 are the same, and so on. Basically, every pair is the same. We could write that much more concisely by just saying that the null hypothesis is system 1 is the same as system 2, is the same as system 3, is the same as all the way up to system n. So in the statistical literature, this is called the omnibus hypothesis, but again, we don't really care about the statistical terms for this. What we want to do is reason from what we know. Okay, so if we have this null hypothesis, then how would we come up with a null distribution that we could use to answer questions about this null hypothesis? So the, again, I think this is where simulation becomes an important thing. The important thing to understand when you have these M systems is that even if they are all the same on average, when you sample values from them, some of them are going to look worse, and some of them are going to look better. And when you look at the actual data you have, you're going to be able to rank those systems in order from worst to best, or from best to worst. Sample 10 values from the normal distribution with mean 0, standard deviation 1, and I'm going to replicate that. And so that gives me a matrix where each column corresponds to, you can think of it as a system or treatment, and each row corresponds to a subject. Now, I don't really care about the individual values. What I care about is the mean. So what I want is the column means. So I want the system means. So when I do that, I get the column means, and now I have 10 different simulated system means. Now just to make this extra clear, I'm going to sort these. And now you can see that even though these 10 simulated systems all have the same mean, they all have the same distribution, or standard deviation, they are identical, the distributions are identical. Despite that, I still see a system that has a measured mean of -0.48 and all the way up to a system that has a measured mean of 0.4, positive 0.4. So even though these 10 systems are actually identical, because I'm just sampling from them, I'm ending up with quite a wide distribution of results. So what can I do with that? How does that help me come up with a solution to this problem? Well, my null hypothesis is that all of these means are equal to each other. So what that means is that if I look at the difference between the maximum and the minimum means, I would want that difference to be non-significant. So I want the difference between the maximum and the minimum to be a non-significant difference. And I want to formulate my null distribution according to that, like that principle, that guiding kind of principle. So how can I do that? So what we want to say is, what is the expected maximum difference between any two systems, given that all of them are equally effective, have the same equal treatment effect in the population, and then use that to compute a null distribution. The easiest way to do this, without having to think about the existing distributions in the literature, without having to go read about different distributions and how to apply them and what their limitations are and everything like that. The easiest thing to do is just set up a randomization test. So just use the randomization framework from Fisher, and in this case, we were going to use it to try to find the maximum differences between systems when we make that assumption that the measurements are not associated with the treatments. So I'm going to try to show you how to do this. So what I need is a matrix of data. So I'm going to run simulate the data the same way as before. If I leave off those mobile parameters, then the defaults are 0 and 1. So that's what our data looks like. And the way the randomization test works, to disassociate the measurements from the treatments, so the treatments again are on the columns, within each row, I'm just going to randomize all the results. So I'm just going to go row by row and just randomize which measurements appear in which cell in that row. And then we'll use for that apply function. I'm going to say apply x, row by row, sample. And when I do this at R, I was going to give me a transpose result, so I need to transpose it to get the result I want. And so basically what you see here is that, for example, this 1.448 has moved from the third column to the first column. This 5356 has moved from the seventh column to the second column, and so on. It's just completely random. So now what I want to do is take that permutation of data. I want to get my system column means, my simulated column means. And when I do that, then I get my column means. And the only value I'm interested in from these column means is the difference between the maximum value and the minimum value. And so there's a special function in R that I can use to get that value. That's called a range function. So I'll apply the range function. That gives me the minimum and the maximum. And then I'll use the diff function to subtract those two values. And that gives me the difference between the maximum and the minimum. And now what I want to do is, just like the randomization test, just do this 10,000 times or 100,000 times or a million times and get a distribution of that value. And that's called my range statistic distribution. So I'm going to do a histogram of the replication of that 10,000 times.
Thank you.
And it looks like this. So you can see it's not a normal distribution. If we had gone and plugged a normal distribution, it's probably would have been wrong. This is called an extreme value distribution. And extreme value distributions typically are skewed either to the right or to the left in the tails, depending on whether you're looking at a max value distribution or a min value distribution. This is a max value distribution, so it's skewed to the right. And it's centered at about 1. So this is our null distribution, and this is the distribution that says the expected difference of 1 between the minimum and the maximum should not be enough to have a significant effect. In order to get what the threshold should be for a significant result, we just go in this distribution, we find where we achieve the 0.05 area under the curve, and wherever that is, we make that value our critical value. And that's the value that we need to see a mean greater than that, or a mean difference greater than that, to say that there's a significant difference. And that essentially solves our that essentially solves our multiple comparisons problem. We have one distribution instead of m squared distributions. Within that one distribution, we could do one critical value, and then we're applying that one critical value to every pair of systems that we have in that experiment to determine significance. And the only criteria now is that if that pair of systems has a difference greater than that threshold, then we would call it significant with the adjustment that we did for the multiple comparison time. So I say susceptibility to MCP is much reduced in this case. It's not eliminated because you can still do a test with 10 experiments. You could do this procedure on that experiment, with that experiment, come up with the results. But then you can do another experiment following that with 10 more tests, and essentially you then kind of have a meta multiple comparisons problem. So, you know, you can apply multiple comparisons to one experiment, but that does not eliminate the multiple comparisons problem. It just kind of raises up the problem. This is an example of applying this the same principle to real evaluation data. And what I found when I did this is that I think I had 128 different treatments I was looking at, and I would need to see a difference in mean average precision of close to 0.12 in order to say that the effect is significant when I have that in the systems. So I hope you can kind of see how you can reason from principles to get to this point. I would not say that every step in that process is obvious. You kind of have to sit down and give it a lot of thought to come up with each subsequent step. But with practice, you get better at doing that. And you also start to understand some of these underlying issues, these underlying considerations, and it makes it a lot easier to use in the future. Basically, what I show you is a randomized version of two of these differences test. So just like the randomization test for Fisher that I showed you at the beginning of this tutorial, it's essentially a randomized version of the t-test. This is a randomized version of the procedure that is well-known and well-studied. So the way this test works is by fitting an ANOVA to all the system's results, and then within that ANOVA, you have your mean square error. You take your range statistic, which is the max max min, you divide it by the MSE, and then that gives you the range statistic. And then you have this Tukey distribution, which Tukey developed and published. And you can find your range statistic in that distribution, coming with the p-value based on that. If you compare that procedure to that randomization test I just showed you, you get very, very similar results, just like when you compare the randomization test. By the way, Tukey has a, he actually published a paper at SIGHOW. He's an author on the SIGHOW paper. That's a, there's a connection between SIGHOW statistics there. So I've been showing you the Track 7 evaluation data. I've been using that for some examples. When you apply this multiple comparisons procedure to that data, so that data consists of 128 different systems. You can do pairwise comparisons on all 128 of those systems and come up with a p-value for each one of those comparisons. But again, you run into that multiple comparisons problem where many of those differences are likely to be false. So if you compare the t-test p-values that you get from doing all pairs to the t-test, to the absolute difference in mean average precision, basically, you can compare the p-values from the all pairs t-tests to the p-values from the multiple comparisons adjusted test, and you can see a huge decrease in the number of pairs that are determined to be significant after the procedure. It's a more honest procedure. It's likely to give you better results, but it's also much harder to get significant results. So I still have a lot of material. I don't have much time left. These slides will be available. I'll put them online. I'll put the notebook online. I'll put a bibliography online. I don't have a link for that yet, but if you follow me on Twitter, I'll tweet it out. Just find me on Twitter. I'll tweet it out at some point. I'm just going to kind of quickly run through some of the highlights of what I have left here. So one thing I've given some thought to is that effectiveness measures, like precision at 10, average precision, they're not measurements in the same sense as height or weight or length. They're really, I think of them as statistics that are summarizing the positions of relevant documents in ranked lists that are seen by users. And if we're coming up with a test that's specific to search, then maybe we should come up with a test that's starting by modeling those individual relevance judgments, rather than modeling the measures. So in order to get into that, I started looking into likelihood ratio tests. So again, I started kind of reasoning from core principles, and I was thinking, what's the likelihood of seeing this particular arrangement of relevant documents given, you know, some null parameters? And so then I said, well, let's make some assumptions. Let's say relevance is generated by flipping a bias coin, and that coin is biased by the system on the top. So we'll just keep it simple. We'll keep it as simple as the t-test. There's a system on the top there. But instead of modeling the effectiveness measure, we're modeling the relevance of the documents. And then we can come up with a model, a test model that looks like this. So now we're generating relevance from a Bernoulli distribution, a coin flip basically. And the probability of that coin flip is linear in the same things that the t-test model is linear in. And we still have a random error. So we still have our basic t-test model, we just put it at a lower level to model the relevance of documents rather than the effectiveness measures. And then we can come up with the test model, there's a likelihood function we can apply, things like that. And then when we actually apply it, we look at precision at 10. It turns out that it actually tracks with, the PIJ, this parameter that models the probability of relevance, turns out to model precision at 10 as well. So what happens is we're doing a test on the ability of the system to retrieve a higher fraction of relevant documents. And what we're getting out of that test is a measure, which is precision at 10. So we did not define precision at 10 in this experiment. Precision at 10 came out of our model of relevance. And we can make this model more complicated. We can add additional things to it. And I made these models quite complicated. And what's interesting is that as they get more complicated, you get more and more complicated user metrics out of them. So you could have a model that this doesn't show it, but you can have a model of how likely the user is to see each document in the ranking, and a model of how useful that is to the user, and then out of that model comes something like DCG, for example. We didn't define DCG, we got DCG from the model that we set up to answer our statistical question about whether two systems are different. The other nice thing about models like this is that they allow us to do, instead of looking at p-values, we can look at posterior probabilities of hypotheses, and we can just compare posterior probabilities, and say it's a more intuitive thing to look at than a p-value is. Again, I have a paper on this. Another thing I want to talk about, I've actually talked about this during this tutorial already, but power analysis is a really important topic. So as I mentioned before, we should not talk about rejecting the null hypothesis. What we should talk about instead is whether we have enough power to reject the null hypothesis that we already know is false, because we designed our experiment so it's false. So first of all, we need to decide what good power is. Typically, 0.8 is considered to be a good level of power. Again, that's a convention, so we don't necessarily have to go with that. We should decide that based on the specific problem that we have. But we don't know what power is a priori when we start out with. So with accuracy, we do know that if we set the test up correctly, then we should have a 5% chance of having a false positive. That's pretty much guaranteed. power, we do not have the same data tonight. So the point of power analysis is before you do the experiment, you do this power analysis to figure out what sample size you need to get the power level that you want for the effect size that you actually want to detect. And I've actually kind of showed you how to do that already. I didn't phrase it in the context of power analysis. But when I was showing you the effect size and the sample size as relates to the effect size and how that relates to the critical value, that's essentially a power analysis that I was doing. And so what that analysis is about is trying to find, for the given critical value that you have in the test, where do you need to find your effect size to have a high probability of rejecting or finding a value of the sample. So as an example, when you start an experiment, what you should say to yourself is, I want to be able to detect an effect size of 0.1 or higher with 80% probability. And those numbers, those specific numbers, should depend on your specific setting, your specific users, all that kind of thing. But you have the idea is that you have those two numbers, and then you design your experiment around those two numbers. And it's fairly easy to do. This is a very simple linear search way to do it. You pick a value, you pick a possible sample size, you plug it in to the test, you see if that gives you the power that you want. If not, then you increase the sample size and find it. Basically, it's just a linear search until you find the sample size that you want. And again, if you understand effect size, you understand how that relates to the critical value, you understand how that relates to the test statistic, then you could come up with this on your own. You don't have to follow this recipe. Bad idea. So this is called power gap. Let's say you have a positive result, but it's not significant. What should I do? Well, should I just get 100 more queries? Should I get 50 more queries? Should I get 50 more queries after that? We've seen already that you can eventually get a significant result if you just keep getting more and more queries, sort of, or more and more subjects. So I don't want to keep going because I've been a little sick, as you can probably tell. I'm starting to lose my voice a little bit, and we are at the time limit. So I'm just going to quickly flash through my slides just to give you a preview of what's in them. I actually talked about some of this already. The ECG stuff. Again, significance tests are just models. We use them out of the box. We fail to model many of the sources of variance that we should be caring about. We probably are modeling things wrong that we could easily model correctly if we thought about it for a second, for an hour, for a day, or for a week. We know, as an example, we know that if we model multiple testing, that can change our conclusions extremely dramatically. So what does that imply? Like, what other things are we failing to model that could change our conclusions equally dramatically? And what are the unknown unknowns? And then I have my last part is kind of this philosophical discussion. Again, you can always find significance. Significance is a rough proxy for interestingness or practical significance, or whatever you want to call it. If you're looking for a recommendation of what test to use, if you talk to me, I'm always going to say the t-test. If you talk to Mark Spucker will say, use the randomization test for the Bootstrap test. People have their own opinions. I think there are some people recently have some papers that say the Wilcoxon test is what you should use. The truth is, it doesn't really matter that much. You should always be aware of the weaknesses of the test. So based on what I've shown you, I think you can probably see how it's possible to search for interesting results, even in an unintentional way. But just by running more and more experiments on larger and larger samples, eventually you're going to find something that is significant, and therefore you could potentially publish. But that doesn't mean it's something that's interesting. And I have some slides about, well, what if we use lower alpha values? Then right now you have all hypotheses, within all hypotheses, there's a very small set that I'm actually interested in. There's a much larger set that are statistically significant. And then there's a set that's published, which intersects the interesting result but doesn't contain all of them. Intersects statistically significant results but doesn't contain all of them. It also includes some non-significant and non-interesting results. If you lower that threshold for significance, then what happens? Basically, these two darker blue circles get smaller. The pink circle stays the same, the large blue circle stays the same. And so what happens is you end up with fewer publications of interesting results. Is that a good thing? You have fewer publications, so there's less to read, for example. But you're also publishing fewer of the interesting results than you would have been publishing. NLP for an hour, this very strong claim. NLP generally doesn't work for an hour. People have disputed that before. But let me explain where I'm coming from with this. I think almost every grad student who studies IR has some idea to apply natural language processing to improve IR. I know I had some when I was a grad student. None of my ideas worked out. And I think for my lab mates, most of their ideas didn't work out. So if you think about it in terms of like multiple comparisons, when you do see a paper that shows some improvement based on NLP techniques, is it because there really was an improvement, or is it because there's thousands of grad students who are all having similar ideas, and one of them happens to get the result that's significant because of who knows why? Now the question though, the question you should ask is, those papers that might be false results, would we be better off if those papers had not been published? I'm not sure about that. Would we be better off if all the negative results, like the results that I came up with, didn't work? Or would we have been better off if I had published those results, even though they were negative? Then if they're published, then maybe the grad students don't actually have to do the work. They don't have to rediscover that the ideas don't work. They can look at the paper and say, oh, that's not going to work. Or are we better off with grad students having actually done the work to gain some intuition and some insight about what those work that they can apply to the future? So what I'm trying to say is that I don't think the answers to these questions are very clear. And what that means to me is that I don't think there's a very clear, I don't have a very clear sense of how statistical significance should be related to our decisions to publish papers. So when I have to talk about reproducibility, I've done some work on this and how that relates to significance as well. I'll end there. So thank you very much, everybody. And again, I'll put all this stuff on the line.
We're taking the
thank you.